Hello and greetings from Iceland. Today I am going to talk about the Reykjanes Peninsula and the large earthquake that occurred in Bárðarbunga Volcano last week. But first, a little travel story since I recently got back from a photo tour where I was able to put my new DJI Air 3 drone to the test, and it is indeed a fantastic drone. The battery lifetime, range, speed, and of course the zoom lens. And due to how the weather has been recently, this was my first real tour with it. So to celebrate it, I got myself a cheesy hot dog and took off to South Iceland, Reykjavík, and the Reykjanes Peninsula, where I was flying around volcanoes, hot springs, and all sorts of formations. And I can truly say,
now I hear the time of my life, though I never felt this way before.
It turned out to be a good decision to upgrade to Air 3, and I did actually use this tour to pick up my good old drone in Reykjavík after the repair. And when I had it back with me, I was thinking that I had more or less everything that I needed in my camera case, finally, even a spare drone. It wasn't however going to stay like that for long. So let's do the volcano update before I do the bummer update. And the volcano update starts by Bárðarbunga. And the biggest question I have about that volcano is it a coincidence that right after earthquakes there in Iceland's hotspot, we see this noticeable uptick in seismic activity on the Reykjanes Peninsula? I've noticed that before and I've mentioned that before here on the channel. So let's look at the earthquake map and start on the westernmost part of the peninsula. As often before, there are frequent offshore earthquakes there. Most of them take place between the mainland and the island Eldey, and under there we have the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And to make it a bit more visible, I made a short time-lapse for fun using the new drone and the zoom lens. And what you see are the heavy tidal currents where they meet the volcano formations on the seabed, making this one of the most dangerous shipping routes by the coasts of Iceland. So there are countless stories of disasters around here. And my next stop is around 20 kilometers away in Grindavík, where I did a thermal scan that turned out to be a bit tricky. It wasn't as cold outside as I hoped for, and you rarely hear an Icelander say that. But I did however find hotspots where I didn't expect to find them. And that is a subject for a separate video. Just like the scan that I did by the highway over the plate boundaries by Hengill Volcano near Reykjavík, it was my third scan there in 6 months, confirming that the ground there is still warming up, and I even found some new hotspots. So the results from there deserve a video on its own, and I will make it very soon. But due to the sun, I didn't do as much thermal work as I would have preferred. But the sun did, however, help me with other projects. Like, I had been wanting to do a video for some time. Perhaps not my most important work right now, but this cone is, however, a geology classroom in a way, and it could just as well be gone tomorrow. So I wanted to have this cross-section on film. So that video will be a nerd special and coming soon. Then I drove through a valley called Móhalsadalur. I spoke about it in my last update. The largest earthquake last week occurred there, magnitude 3.3, and there is this sealed volcano formation in a valley that is an important piece of the story I've been making about the volcanoes around the city. So I was using the trip to fill up some gaps in my photo stock for the unfolding story on the Reykjanes Peninsula. But as for the big question today, is Bárðarbunga Iceland's hotspot getting ready to erupt, and how could it play out? Icelandic scientists have been saying that Bárðarbunga's magma chamber is inflating after the 2014 eruption, and those earthquakes are quite normal for that sake. And we were led to believe in 2014 that the eruption back then was only a part of a larger chain of events. In fact, we were very lucky back then. the ice-filled caldera didn't erupt itself. Instead, the magma chamber under a volcano formed this lateral dike that was responsible for the so-called Holuhraun eruption in 2014. Luckily, far away from any human settlements. And the full story of Bárðarbunga is actually something I'm working on. So a few weeks ago, I took off to a place called Vatnaöldur, a part of the 200 km long Bárðarbunga volcanic system, to get footage that would show the forces under there. The Vatnaöldur eruption came up through a dike intrusion 50 km away from Bárðarbunga's magma chamber, and it was groundwater at a little depth that made the eruption so highly explosive, and this devastating outcome occurred shortly before the settlement of Iceland, 1100 years ago. And it created a distinctive tephra layer that ever since has been very useful to date all sorts of events in the history of Iceland. And this layer is called the settlement layer. So Bárðarbunga is one of the big ones, if not the biggest. And every time there is a magnitude 3 plus earthquake there, it will be in the news 5 minutes later. So I'm hoping to find some time soon to make a Bárðarbunga video covering the basics, or one of those videos that I can refer to when things heat up. I am, however, not convinced that Bárðarbunga is going to erupt soon. But earthquakes there might trigger an eruption in the nearby Grímsvötn system that is more than ready for an eruption. And when I made my prediction for this year in January, I was sure it was going to be Grímsvötn and the Reykjanes Peninsula that would erupt in 2023. But along the way, I changed my mind and expected Askja to be the one to erupt instead of Grímsvötn, but I'm changing my mind again, and Grímsvötn it is. But we might, however, get a surprise. This is Iceland, and since we are into October, that is actually Katla's time. It's this time of year when Katla tends to tease us a bit with earthquakes, and she has already started. Katla is, however, so unpredictable that I'm not going to say too much now, other than I would not be surprised if she would at least send us a few teasers in the coming days and weeks. And as for the Reykjanes Peninsula, I want to repeat what I said in my last update. We could get big news from there anytime, although things are quiet right now, and I'm actually fine with that since I've been putting a lot of time and energy to keep up with what's happening there, or since June. And back to this photo tour of mine, that started with drama and ended with drama. The first shots were drama shots by Hofsjökull Glacier on the highlands. There is a volcano under this glacier that has been sending us some surprise earthquakes every now and then, and it is just so much more fun to make updates when I can spice them up with some footage. So that's the reason why I did this detour. And there was actually way more drama to be found by the road on the way back to North Iceland. The day started well with good weather. I filmed yet another town for my town series to edit this winter, and I got good light for that job and some nice autumn scenes. And when I had finished there, I had like 15 minutes left of battery time in the new drone. Or when I got to those cliffs not far away from home. So I decided to send the new drone up one more time to see how well it did in low light. And I was also thinking about the zoom lens, how well it would capture the cliffs, since it has been my plan for a long time to make a video from them. And I did actually go there last spring to practice, check the place out, or map the dream trip that I planned to do when I would get fantastic light late summer or early winter. So this was practice number two there. It's getting dark fast, and the new drone said, okay, Gylfi, I'm not going to do more for you today since you didn't buy me a car charger yet. And as I sometimes do, I did one more short round, which is within the limits. Then I set the drone into sport mode that turns off the obstacle sensors and flew almost straight down, just slightly backwards. And I decided to keep the cliffs in the frame and continue to film on the way back down or until shortly before landing. And that turned out to be a big, big mistake. So to make this short, the zoom lens made me think that I was closer to the cliffs than I actually was, and the new drone is way faster than the old one. I got the ultimate punishment for a drone pilot error, the worst pilot error I've ever made. I flew it straight into the ground with the obstacle sensors turned off. It is not in good shape. So I placed it in appropriate box and gave it a good send off. It is gone to meet its maker. We had joy, we had fun, we had seasons and the sun, but the stars we could reach were just starfish on the beach. Or the DJI factory, that will fix it. And the DJI guys in Reykjavik actually called me while I was doing this voiceover. And the repair is a bit less than I expected, so it could have been worse. The drone wasn't insured, so I decided to make a drone failure video soon, since I've actually kept all such files since drone number one. Mostly minor incidents while I was still learning, and good information for new pilots. And overall, I consider myself to have been quite lucky with this, given how much I've been flying around. But there was more to this trip than just this, and it's often been said that bad luck comes in threes. I was actually both tired and frustrated on the way back, since my car was failing on me as well. I was not even sure if I would get it home without a tow truck, but I did. And 2 days after the trip, I came down with a cold for the first time in I think 5 years. So that's why I haven't been uploading anything for a while now. I am, however, getting back little by little, thanks to Icelandic lamb meat soup with a bunch of garlic, and I've used the last days to color grade and noise clean a bunch of footage, so I can do my next videos faster. But as for this incident, it is a setback for me, of course, but I will get the drone within a week, and this decision of mine to keep the old drone as a spare has already been justified. But how I fix the car problem, it's not clear yet. It looks now as his days are numbered. It wasn't an expensive car, so I'm not going to spend a lot of money on it. But the good news is that I captured more and less all the footage I hoped to get this summer, despite the eruption that took some time from me. And I have invested a lot in camera gear, so I'm better equipped than ever. But what I didn't know when I started this journey on the channel is that I would be making a kind of diary about this major geological event that might shape the history of the Reykjanes Peninsula and actually Reykjavik in the coming years and decades. So the frequency of those events during this year especially have interrupted lots of my other plans, but that's just how it is. Now is the time to sit down in front of the computer and work on some of the longer videos I've been pushing aside and finish to sort and tag all footage on my hard drives, and I won't be on the road again until I've fixed this car issue. And finally, I'm leaving links in the video description to the methods to support my work while my channel still needs it, with many thanks to you who have been helping out since this started. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the Volcano Island, Iceland.